This is a Radio.com original.
This is Coronavirus Daily. I'm Charles Feldman.
And I'm Mike Simpson.
We will be here every day to bring you the very latest up-to-date information to help guide you and your family through this new global coronavirus pandemic.
Because a lot is changing. Every 24 hours, it seems, a lot's changed since just the weekend. There are millions of people now living in entire regions of the country that have these shelter-in-place orders. That means stay inside your home unless it's absolutely necessary. And then there's bars and restaurants. They've been ordered to close. So what other steps might be needed as we move forward?
Yeah, and I know a lot of people are probably thinking, wow, if I had to shelter in place, you know, what does that mean? And how inconvenient is that going to be? And yet it may be necessary even in your community.
Yeah, we keep getting the questions, you know, can I go for a walk? Still, yeah. I can go to the store, but I got to walk the dog. What if I'm hungry? Order from a restaurant, they're saying get to-go orders only.
Well, and understandably, nervous shoppers, they're crowding grocery stores. And I saw them myself, Mike, over the weekend. They are clearing shelves faster than they can be restocked. So here's the question. Is the country's food supply deep enough to handle the demand?
Yeah. And then there's the business aspects. CEOs and managers, they're under a lot of pressure. What do you do for the employees who can't go to work now, especially if you've got an hourly job or you're a restaurant worker, a service worker? You depend on a job that, well, isn't going to exist for a little while. Well, or a long while.
Well, and that's a tough one. And that is all leading to worry, anxiety. Hey, forget anxiety. Even in many cases, panic, because what's been unleashed is all because of this invisible enemy, this virus. So we are going to try to explain how you can keep yourself, your family, as calm as possible as we all get through this together.
So it is a new week. Let's just start with the big picture. Dr. David Agus is an oncologist and founding director of USC's Ellison Institute for Transformative Medicine. So, doctor, let's try and find some kind of silver lining, even if it sounds like a silly question. Is there any good news that we can tell people right now?
The therapeutics that are being used now to try to fight this virus are starting to show that they're working. And so this is an RNA virus, which means it has no machinery to divide on its own. It's not alive. So it actually gets into our body, gets into our own cells, and uses our machinery to divide. Where there were drugs that were developed for Ebola and for HIV that blocked this machinery working, and they work in this virus. They're being used now in Seattle in the initial patients there. They're being used now in multiple cities across the country and in China. And so there's certainly hope in that regard. You know, the game we're playing now, and it really is, you know, strategically almost like a game, which we're trying to quarantine and lessen social interactions, is meant to slow the virus. If we can slow the virus, these medicines will be ready, and our medical infrastructure will be ready to handle people who get this virus.
We heard Dr. Fauci in the news conference with the president saying, look, whatever we do is going to look on the outset like an overreaction, like shut everything down. And people go, seriously, do we have to do that? Can't we just stay a few feet apart? But you got to take it seriously because it's not actually an overreaction.
No, I mean, you know, the death rate in people under 60 is minimal. The problem is in the decades of the 70s, the 80s, those have significant death rates. And so we are putting very large programs in place to block social interactions to benefit a small portion of the population. We're one community. And so it's an amazing time where America has stepped up to protect a small number of people. And my hope is, and I think it will work, we will slow the spread of the virus. And what we're going to do is save many lives. If we can delay the virus from spreading, we're going to save tens of thousands of lives that don't need to be lost.
Let me ask you something about those age things, because I know that there are people who are listening and they hear you talk about the death rate being significantly higher for those in their 70s, those in their 80s. But I also know that there are probably people who are listening right now who are thinking, well, gee, you know, I'm like 69. I'm going to be 70 in 3 months. What are we talking about there?
So when you look at the data, you know, it's not, no matter how healthy you are, it's actually the age. As you get older, the portal for entry in the virus, the receptor of the virus actually goes up. So if you look at the South Korea data, which is more analogous to us, they have an excellent medical infrastructure system. 80 and older had a death rate of 8.3%. 70 to 79 had a 4.74% death rate. 60 to 69, 1.42. Under the age of 60, the death rate was 0.1%. Under the age of 50, you know, there were only two deaths among 4,800 people. So the key here is, you know, the people who are elderly, no matter what shape they're in, are more susceptible. We have to protect them.
People got a lot of questions when we talk about shelter in place. What does that really mean? You can still go to the grocery store, but stay socially distanced from people as best as possible, right? You can still take the dog for a walk, that kind of a thing. You can go outside, just try not to get close to people.
Yeah, I think, you know, what we're seeing now are regulations that vary based on where you are, what city you are, what part of the country you're on, what part of the state you're in. I think over the next couple of days, we may have more standards where the federal government may say, hey, this is what you have to do. But it's using common sense and social distancing. You know, if you're over the age of 60 and you want to go to the grocery store, I want you to call first and figure out when it's not busy, because that's when you want to go. You don't want to go when there's a long line and people are congregated together. You want to go when you're the only person in the store, when it first opens or late at night, something along those lines. I think we all have to kind of think in those regards, especially if you're elderly or you live or have access to somebody who is elderly. And when I say elderly, I also mean medical conditions. If you have any existing medical conditions, that puts you at higher risk.
Okay. Dr. David Agus, oncologist, founding director, USC's Ellison Institute for Transformative Medicine. Dr. Agus, thanks.
All across the country, you know, you can go to large supermarkets, smaller grocery stores, and you are likely to find scenes that are very, very similar. Long lines, really long waits. And then, you know, you go inside, and I did this weekend.
Same,
right? Pretty much empty shelves, especially frozen foods, and yes, of course, toilet paper.
Toilet paper
good
and
luck.
Paper towels.
Yeah, good luck.
They're all gone.
Finding toilet paper.
So what's going on, and do we have enough stuff that's going to be left? How is the food supply among all these panic buyers? Britton Ladd is founder and CEO of Six Page Consulting. He's a former Amazon exec and helps engineer their purchase of Whole Foods. So we keep hearing, and we've had mayors out with grocery executives today saying, look, there is no shortage of food. There's no shortage of anything else. So why don't we have any things on the shelves?
This is really a manufactured panic by the consumer. Nothing has been disrupted. We can still grow food. We can harvest food. We can process the food. We can manufacture food, deliver the food, distribute it, and we can even still do delivery to the home. So nothing has been disrupted in terms of the infrastructure for us to meet all of our needs for food. People have a tendency to panic, and that's why the phrase panic buy has been applied to what we see in the grocery stores. But make no mistake, everything remains to meet our food needs that existed before the coronavirus came along.
So we're just buying too much too fast, and the restocking isn't happening. It can't happen quickly enough. Is that why some stores have changed their hours so they get time overnight to put things back on the shelves before everybody rushes in again?
Exactly. In supply chain, there's what's called the bullwhip effect. And right now, the bullwhip effect is there's a massive demand increase. I mean massive. And so what's happening is that the grocery stores have to adjust to the increased demand. And they're putting all of their factories on maximum production. Everybody is ordering more product. But that product takes time to manufacture. It takes time to get to the stores. So literally within the next week to 2 weeks at most, those shelves are going to be full again. The problem is this. If consumers continue to panic buy, then this is just a vicious cycle of the bullwhip. It goes up, then it goes down. It goes up and down.
Well,
and that's what we'll face.
Okay, but isn't part of the problem that the uncertainty of whether or not they're going to have to remain in place, you know, that someone in their office is going to be sick and they're going to be told, oh, you know, you were exposed to that person. You got to hang out in your house. Don't go outside for 14 days. So people think, well, I need to really stock up on stuff if I can't go shopping for 2 weeks.
Oh, no, that's true. But a lot of people have failed to realize that online delivery is absolutely available. Restaurant delivery is still available. And in a case like that, I would hope these individuals would have at least one person that they could turn to to help them go to a store and get their grocery needs. So I understand the level of panic. What I'm saying is the infrastructure is so good in the United States for groceries, you're not going to see massive amounts of people staying indoors starving. It's not going to happen.
Although the delivery, I mean, you mentioned that. You tried last week or this weekend to do Amazon Prime or to do Instacart in L.A., and there aren't any delivery times, even for two or 3 days, and it kind of just locks you out and says try back later. Are there moves to try and bulk that up? Can you do it quickly to get more drivers?
Well, it is actually starting to bulk up, and yes, they are able to get more drivers. And again, just as there's a bullwhip effect of panic buying in the stores, now there's a panic to how do we get more drivers. But a lot of people who wanted to do this as a job are already driving. So now they're attracting more drivers, and they're also changing how they distribute groceries. So more of the focus is on last mile delivery instead of people coming to the stores. Give it another week or two and watch how much progress they've made.
Now, what's the story, though, with things like soap and hand sanitizer? Because some of the other items, like toilet paper, some of the stores, they don't have it on one day, but they have it the next day. The one thing that has been, or the two things now, that are increasingly absent permanently, it seems, hand sanitizer, and often now soap. Is it just that the companies that make these products really have to ramp up more?
They do have to ramp up more. They are usually on a very set schedule for capacity, meaning they dedicate a certain amount of capacity for soap, toilet paper, hand sanitizer. So when suddenly that's disrupted and demand increases by several 100% to several 1,000%, these factories don't have the ability to turn on a dime and just manufacture more. So the reason why you may be able to go to the store tomorrow and see something in stock, it's because as soon as they manufacture the product, it's being delivered. And so it gets to the stores, people send a message on social media that there's toilet paper, and what happens? There's a run on the store, and people buy it as fast as they can. So once people calm down and realize that they can get food, they can get soap and so forth, this will start to smooth out. And then you'll see that the panic buying will decrease and the shelves will have much more product on them. It's just going to take another week or two at most.
Britton Ladd, founder and CEO of Six Page Consulting, former Amazon exec, helped engineer their purchase of Whole Foods.
You know, we've been hearing from medical experts all across the country, actually, really, it's the world, right, about warning of overcrowding, warning of overtaxing the healthcare system because of the virus. Now, so far, at least in terms of the healthcare system, that hasn't been the case. But that is the case in the business world across the country. It is getting slammed.
Yeah, so you try and prevent the surge of patients by shutting things down. And that has the effect on the businesses because you can't go out to a restaurant anymore. You can't go to the bar because they're closed. Movie theaters. Tom Gimbel's founder and CEO of LaSalle Network. It's a large employment agency based in Chicago. He talks with WBBM's Noon Business Hour with Cisco Cotto and Jennifer Kuiper about how companies are coping with all the changes that keep happening so quickly.
It really is right out of a movie. And whether people believe that it's being overly dramatic or that it's being under executed is really irrelevant because it's happening. And CEOs today have to be communicating with their teams, their clients, and their vendors in a way that they've never had to before.
Do you think that some of the workplace changes that we're going to be seeing now and in the days, maybe even weeks to come, going into effect, could they stay in effect?
I don't really see that happening. What we're finding out is that technology is allowing us to do things we never could have done before. Imagine if this problem would have hit us 20 years ago, before video conference, and only 20 years ago. We still had the internet, but before video conferencing, texting really wasn't a commonplace occurrence, and we just had begun having email in every company and individual. We would have been on the phone trying to have conference calls and do things. It would have been such a bigger challenge. So, yes, technology is allowing us to navigate this easier. But what we're also finding out is how important a central location where a majority of the workforce is, to getting things done. And it's great to have some companies that have flexible work operations, but when every company has it, it's really challenging.
Do you have any tips for employees who are working from home for the first time? A lot of people are just not used to this.
So first and foremost, you've got to establish a routine. You've got to get up at the same time that you were getting up before. You don't have the commute. And for all those people that complained about having a commute, now you have the time to make use of it. Get up, do your exercise, do your laundry, do whatever the chores are. Start your job at the same time you would normally start your job. And the biggest thing I'm telling all of my clients and what we're doing internally at LaSalle Network, Zoom conversations as often as you can versus just voice or email, because we're going to be longing for this connectivity. We need to see each other's faces.
Tom, is there something unique that you've seen a company or companies do that you thought, hey, that's kind of interesting?
Yeah, I read an article the other day, and this is just a fun thing from a culture perspective, but we're big Zoom users, and we've got about 300 employees at our company, and we're going to do a virtual happy hour, because you know what? Everybody's going to get on with their beverage of choice or a glass of water or whatever they want, but at 5:30 tonight, we're going to try to bring some normalcy into a little bit of a crazy period of time. And it's not mandatory. If you want to log on, log on. If you don't, you don't. But we've got to do things to show people that work can still be fun and we can laugh even during crazy times.
Well, there's less of a chance of you doing something inappropriate during the virtual happy hour.
You won't be touching anybody. And, you know, you may have your pajamas on, but in this situation, Cisco, it's okay.
You want to do a lot of, you do want to do those team building things, because when people are remote, especially the extroverts like me, I mean, you just start to miss being around your team.
Oh, I think I was talking to some executives today, and just from the weekend of being self-quarantined, they were going stir crazy. And it wasn't even the first Monday through Friday. So, yes, the type A's need the interaction, and the phone just gets... It's too easy to be multitasking when you're on the phone. And to have the video conferencing is really crucial to build interaction. Now, the one thing is that if you're dealing with clients or vendors, you got to still look good if you're doing the video calls. So you got to, whether it's women and who wear makeup or men having their hair combed or wearing a decent shirt, not a ripped up T-shirt or whatever it is you want to make sure that you're behaving in a professional way, because there's a lot of mind over matter in this situation, and optimism and feeling that you're still a professional, because you are. It's only been a couple days here, is really crucial to the task at hand.
Thank you, Tom Gimbel. He is founder and CEO of LaSalle Network.
We are living, I think it's fair to say, Mike, we are living in a very different America than the one we were all living in only a week ago.
Yeah.
And the virus clearly is changing everything you can think of. I mean, think about that. Everything in our daily lives. And that change and that uncertainty is really getting people nervous. It is getting them anxious. And it is causing some, unfortunately, to panic.
It's the pace of it, too, right?
Yeah.
You go over the weekend and it's completely different than the weekend before that. And then you don't know what next week is going to bring.
And it's nonstop bad news.
Yeah. Especially if you listen or you watch the news.
Yeah.
It can be difficult. So let's turn to psychotherapist Dr. Robbie Ludwig.
Oh, please, yes. Please.
Please help us. She talked to Wins's Kathleen Maple about how we can all step back, take a deep breath, and just try to relax.
Even though COVID-19 is potentially dangerous, in most cases, it's mild and it's not lethal. And that we need to take control of the things that we can take control of and the things that work. So we hear it a lot, washing your hands in the proper way, not touching your face, social distancing. If you're feeling sick, stay home. If you can stay home from work and do things remotely, ask your boss if you can do that. We have the benefit of learning from other countries what to do so that we can take control a bit more of the numbers of cases of the people who can get very sick.
A lot of folks have older relatives, and a lot of us have older loved ones who are involved in our lives. What are some of the things we should be telling our older loved ones to make them feel better? Because if you're 80 years old or a little younger, this is pretty scary when you see that mortality curve.
One of the challenges for older people right now is the social isolation and the loneliness sometimes that they can feel through disconnection. So this is a really good time to call frequently, to ask your loved ones how they're doing, to make them feel loved, to just be curious about them. Because there's a difference between social distancing and disconnecting. We all want to stay connected to one another so that we don't feel like we don't matter. And social connection emotionally is so important to our mental health, which we really need to take control of during these times.
You're making a really good point with that. I've seen some articles lately about how people handled earlier outbreaks and how we tend to dehumanize almost people who get sick. Sooner or later, we're going to know people who get sick. What should we do at that point?
Well, if we do know people who get sick, it's just like anything else. You want to check in on them, see how they're feeling. If you're living with somebody who's sick, you want to check with their doctor or your doctor on how to interact so that everyone can stay as healthy as possible. You know, we do have professionals out there, and they are guides. We don't need to go through this alone. And if you are in a healthy state right now, it's always best to take care of yourself in terms of eating right and exercising, meditating if you need to, getting the right sleep, because there's a paradox here. If we stress ourselves out too much, then we make ourselves vulnerable to getting sick in multiple ways. So it's a great time for self-care, reaching out to professionals, using one source for information, and not getting overloaded are great tips right now.
You make a very good point about reaching out to professionals. I assume you are no fan of Dr. Twitter.
Dr. Twitter, right. And you know, bad information is dangerous. Panicking can get us to make poor choices. So let's stay centered here. There is information. There are strategies. We do know some of these strategies really work. Again, to keep in mind that the coronavirus is not necessarily lethal. Many people will have it and get through it until we find a vaccine for it. But it's nice to know that some of the things that are out there that are being recommended really can reduce the amount of cases that we will see moving forward.
Dr. Robbie Ludwig, psychotherapist and author, thank you.
Okay, so how are you feeling?
You mean after listening to the psychotherapist?
The optimal word is try, right? Try,
yeah,
and relax.
I guess I feel a little better, and hopefully people listening will feel a little better. But, you know, look, the news, we're not going to sugarcoat anything, especially on this podcast. The news at the moment is not bright.
It's not cheerful. Great.
No. It's pretty dark, but there are always, I would like to think, some, you know, silver linings to these clouds.
And you look for good people out there helping, you know, help someone if you got a neighbor who's 80 or 90 and definitely can't go out.
Right.
Go and get some groceries.
When I go home, I'm going to have an ice cream.
That's how you cope.
Yeah, because I deserve it. I want an ice cream.
Do what makes you happy.
You know, Las Vegas casinos, they are known, if you've ever been to Vegas, folks, they never close. Have you ever heard last call, you know, shouted at any of them? No, you haven't.
Only before they demolish the old ones.
But starting tomorrow, 14 resorts along the Las Vegas Strip will actually shut down temporarily because of the concerns about the virus. Now, they're going to include Wynn, Encore, Mirage, Mandalay Bay, New York, Luxor, Excalibur, Bellagio. The Strip today is emptying out as people just leave Las Vegas.
It's that same kind of Disneyland effect. You know, some people knew it was real when Disneyland closed.
And now Vegas.
Now it's the casinos,
Vegas.
Too. All right. Well, you can find this radio.com original podcast and others on radio.com, the radio.com app, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Stitcher. And we will be back tomorrow. We're going to do this again, keeping you up to date on the very latest every single day as
we
move through this.
Because we don't sleep. No, we are here
not
like
a lot
24/7.